You know, I could play this stuff all night. Hi guys, how you doing? Nick Jennison for GI. Thank you so much for joining me once again on a Monday evening where we do the thing that we do on Monday evenings, which is hang out and talk about the guitar. And today we're kicking off a new series of live streams on the subject of practice strategies. Yes, you read it right, practice strategies. We're gonna be talking about ways that you can optimize your practice, for whatever that word means. You can optimize your practice and get the most out of your sessions and the most development for the least amount of time invested, which is what we want. So, before we get stuck in, I just want to take a moment to thank you guys for joining me. If you are watching the stream for the first time, let us know in the comments. We would love to hear from you. We are, of course, live on Facebook. We're live on Twitch. We're live on YouTube. We'll be taking comments from all of these platforms and we'll be answering your questions in the Q&A. So let's just check in with the chat and see who's joining us. The Perspective Podcast is joining us on Twitch and says, hey there, Perspective Podcast. Hey there, it's nice to have you on board. Thanks for joining us. Who else do we have? Our friend Baptiste says, hi Nick, how are you? Baptiste, I am great, as per usual. It's Monday night, I'm talking about guitar, I'm playing guitar. What is not to love? Thanks for joining me though, really appreciate it. Marcin says, let's go, long before the stream started. So a long time friend of the stream is Marcin. Our friend Spaceman1111 says, hi Nick, greetings from Texas. Real quick before we get too stuck in with this. I want to know where you guys are tuning in from. So let us know in the comments where you're watching from. We would love to hear from whereabouts in the world our viewers are tuning in from. Let us know what platform you're on as well, of course. We've had people from all over the place, man. We've had people from Nepal, we've had people from South America, people from the United States, people from 5 minutes from my house. It's very, very cool indeed. Our friend Dimitri says, hi Nick, how you doing? I'm doing great, mate. Thank you very much. It's good to have you. So as per usual, best ways that you can support this stream, if that's something you'd like to do, you can give us a thumbs up on whatever platform you're watching. You can share this video with your guitar playing friends. All of this helps us get this content out to as many guitar players as we can. We think there's a lot of cool stuff in here, and of course it's free, so we'd like to get it out to as many players as we can. Another way you can support the stream is by checking out GI Plus. GI Plus is of course the exclusive lesson platform for all things guitar related. From GI, you get not only every lesson that GI has ever put out, but also a ton more. And we've also just opened a backing track portal as well. So all the backing tracks that you're going to find on these streams are available for you on GI Plus. And if you're a GI Plus member, you can get them to keep. So you can download them, use them for whatever you like. So anyway, here we go. Cody English is tuning in from Oklahoma. Says, man, that was nice. Thank you very much. Really appreciate it, man. Tin Man Tin, friend of the stream, Detroit in the house, from Detroit Rock City, no less. Want to go back up here. Guitar Pits, I'm guessing. Yeah, why not? Guitar Pits says, I love your guitar. I love my guitar too. 24 frets, more is more, says Marcin. We do like a bit of that sort of stuff. More is more. More is always more. I always need more practice, says Guyver1. So anyway, let's keep on moving. Oh, we've also got some Malmsteen comments. I'll be dropping some Malmsteen in a bit later on because we love a bit of Malmsteen. How can this be more? More is more. Straight up, I can't do the Malmsteen accent. It always comes out sounding like Arnold, so I'm not going to try. Palm Bay, Florida, a new friend of the stream, Dave Barnes. Dave, it is great to have you. Blue Sumlin is in the chat, so all of our familiar faces are here. Again, if you're tuning in, drop us a comment, let us know. If you've got any questions at any point, we will be answering them live on camera. But let's get stuck in with the meat of today's lesson, which is practice strategies. Today, we're going to talk about strategies for practicing technical things. So we'll be doing a few of these streams. We're going to be doing one on practicing your vocabulary and developing your vocabulary as an improviser. We're going to do one on learning stuff, like how you can learn songs and like batches of songs very quickly. Let's say you have a last minute gig that's come in. But today we're going to talk about technique and how we might develop it. So first of all, let's talk about why you might want to develop your technique. Well, technique's cool. We like technique, right? It's not the be all and end all, as people have rightly pointed out. out, but it is cool. We like a bit of technique, and of course, without technique, nobody would be able to play anything on the guitar, and that would suck. So what we're not talking about necessarily is turning you into a shred robot, although if that's the sort of thing that you're into, more power to your elbow. But what we are talking about is refining your technical process and your technical ability so you can get the most out of your playing. So let's start with kind of point number one, which is isolating the things that you want to work on. And I guess this starts with a little bit of a needs analysis. Now, a needs analysis is basically where you might examine your playing and go, you know, I need to work on this. So with that in mind, drop us some comments and let us know what you feel like you need to work on in your own guitar playing from a technical perspective. But I'm gonna work on the idea of a hypothetical guitar player that needs to work on their left-hand finger independence. So let's go to the close-up cam and let's take a little bit of a look at what I'm talking about. So finger independence is quite simply your ability to move your fingers without them interfering with each other, so to speak. Now, this is something that is easier said than done for a lot of guitar players. So what I'm gonna do real quick, I'm just gonna throw my backing track back on and I'm gonna start playing some lines that might benefit from a little bit of finger independence. Let me show you what I'm talking about. So let's fire it up. Here we go, backing track. So what I'm talking about here is playing lines that aren't necessarily straightforward like this. Now, just because it's fast doesn't mean it's not straightforward. I'm just gonna throw that out real quick. So we're playing lines where everything is kind of one note stacked after another in order, and it's fine, it sounds cool. That's where our finger independence really becomes something that's useful to us. So let's maybe try some more of those. Let's try something like... So, some fairly complex stuff. Fairly complex stuff. But let's talk about how we might develop that. So, the first thing to do, if you're struggling with your finger independence, I guess, is, and this applies to any technical issue, by the way, this is not strictly finger independence, this is just how to find and troubleshoot technical issues. So let's talk about finger independence though. So the thing to identify is where you're struggling. So let's maybe do a little bit of a hypothetical look at where I might struggle with my own finger independence. So what I might do is I might look at some finger pairs, and I might look at the idea of playing between finger one and two, let's say, like so. Feels pretty good. Let's just throw a clean sound on for this, actually, by the way. Let's do finger one and three. Clean-ish sound. Finger one and four. Yep. Fine, no problem. Finger two and four. Little more awkward. Finger two and three, surprisingly challenging. Finger three and four, surprisingly easy. So that was weird, right? That's not what I expected. So finger two and three, surprisingly difficult. And let's try maybe triples. Let's try three fingers at a time. So maybe finger one, two, three. How do they sound? Yeah, nothing to worry about there. Let's do fingers one, two, four. Nothing to worry about there. Fingers one, three, four. Fingers two, three, four. Ooh, that's a bit of a sticky little combination. I'm not a huge fan of that. That feels pretty awkward. My compressor is grabbing extremely hard today, so I'm just going to turn that off. So that's challenging, right? So right away, what I found there is I found something that is difficult, something that's going to be troublesome for me. So what I might do is I might try and construct some exercises. And it doesn't really matter what specific exercise we do here, but I might try and construct some exercises that target that tricky little combination of two, three, and four. But then again, I've established that fingers 3 and 4 want to work together quite well. They're okay. It's really fingers 2 and 3 that are the problem. So what I might do is I might throw a drum loop on. I've just got one rigged up here real quick. Hopefully you guys can hear this. I'm just going to make sure it's coming out of the right output on my DAW. Bear with me. So yeah, I've got a little drum loop rigged up here. I'll do the trick. Hopefully you guys can hear that okay. Let me know if you can hear the drums, by the way. Do let me know. So what I might do is I might try playing something that biases very, very strongly on fingers 2 and 3. So what I might try doing is, instead of playing this typical exercise that everybody plays all the time, what I may try doing is I may try just backtracking between finger 2 and 3 a little more. So I might try going. So right there, I found an exercise that I like that works with fingers 2 and 3. Into that, really, really cool. So I might try moving that around the strings. I might go. Into that, that works really well. So what I have going on there is I've got a little exercise that I'm into that works for me with my fingers 2 and 3. So we've identified a problem and we found an exercise that is going to attack it. Now the theory with this is that because I'm targeting a specific technical issue that I have, I'm going to be able to get more repetitions of this particular exercise in, or more repetitions of fingers 2 and 3 in, than if I just played this exercise, for example. There's nothing wrong with this exercise. I'll just throw that out there right now. There's nothing wrong with that. That's fine. But if we take a look at the number of notes I need to play to get my fingers 2 and 3, and I go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and let's say, you know, we pause that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Let's do that. There's one pass from low to high on finger 2 and 3, and there's one pass from high to low. So we have two instances of finger 2 and 3 in eight notes here. What I have going on in my own little exercise is this. So I have one movement, a movement back down, moving back up, that's three, moving back down, that's four, moving back up, that's five, and then, so it's five repetitions between finger 2 and 3. As opposed to that in the same time. So the amount of time that I'm practicing, I can get more than double the number of exposures to this little exercise, which is very cool. I'm really into that. So that's just one example. Now, what I will say here is that this exercise is not a magical exercise. It's literally just one I've made up on the spot. So let's take another example. Let's say I didn't really have a particular finger problem that I wanted to solve. I just wanted to maybe play some scales and work on the idea of improving, you know, watching the TV or something. And I wanted to just, you know, fiddle away on some scales and get my fingers moving. So what I could do is I could just run scales up and down like we tend to do as guitar players. I'll throw my drums back on, where we might get this sort of thing, which everyone does all the time. And it's fine, absolutely nothing wrong with it. But there might be a scale out there that is going to give me more exposure to more fingering combinations. So what I might do is I might go looking through my collection of scale shapes, and I might find a scale shape that has more than just these three fingering shapes in it. So one that I like to use quite a lot, just a little warm up, is I like to use the seventh position of the three note per string melodic minor. You don't need to know this scale, by the way, you can go and look it up later, but purely because it has absolute ton of various different fingering combinations in there. We've got a 1, 2, 4, we have a stretched out 1-2-4, a 1-3-4, another 1-2-4, a stretched out 1-3-4, and then like a 1-3-4 without a stretch at the top. Now, I'm going to point this out here real quick. Paul B has said, any tabs for this? Paul B, I could give you tabs for this, but it kind of defeats the point, because what we're looking at here is we're looking at the idea of you developing your own exercises to target specific aspects of your own playing that you feel like you maybe need improving on. So I could, but I'd be doing you a disservice if I gave you tabs, because it's not about these specific exercises that I'm doing. It's more about a principled guide for things. So anyway, so let's keep going. So that's principle number one, is targeted... like kind of targeted exercise selection. Now, if you don't have a targeted exercise or a particular target, you just want to do some time putting in some work and developing your air quotes technique, because that's the focus of today's lesson, is technique stuff. Well, what you can do is you can do something like that melodic minor exercise, which is kind of more of a catch-all. It's about the idea of kind of selecting exercises that are going to give you the most mileage for your money. Now, let's get on to another principle. Now, the next principle we're going to talk about is variation. So variation is really, really important for this. Now, the reason that variation is important is not just because it makes you a more rounded player, but because all studies recently that have been conducted on the way we learn motor skills, there's been loads of scientific studies about this lately, have found that close variations to the exercise that you're playing kind of get you, it gets your brain working in a different way. It makes, you know, solving these problems gives you, it seems to reinforce the skill that you're trying to develop a lot more tightly. So let me show you what I'm talking about when I say close variations. Let's throw this on. So we've got our drums back on real quick. Let's just fire this away. If I took the idea very, very quickly of, again, let's just maybe take this idea of playing this spider exercise. Let's keep it real simple. So this exercise here is 1-2-3-4. Dead, dead easy. Now, if I wanted to develop this, I could just hammer on this exercise forever, and I would get better, but I'd get better faster if I found close variations that I could work on. Now, the reason for this, again, is because problem solving, solving problems in your practice, and solving the problem of close variations is key to developing motor skills and developing motor pathways at a faster pace. So it's going to give you more bang for your buck, so to speak. So what might I mean by a close variation? Well, let's throw this open to the comments. So how are we going to vary this exercise to make it more challenging? I have a couple of ideas, but I'd like to know what you guys think. So let me know, what do you think we could do to this exercise to vary it? Now, let's throw the baby out with the bathwater here, and let's say we were going to vary the idea that we're practicing so much that it no longer resembles the idea that we're practicing. So we could change it from this into something finger twisting like this. That's an exercise that I play fairly frequently. It's one my friend Nick Harrison gave to me. And so on and so forth. So it is a little challenging, but it's not really that close to this exercise. And the issue with changing it so much is that we then have to spend the time to learn our new exercise, and that's time we could be practicing. So that's not what I'd really necessarily consider a close variation. So a close variation might be something like, instead of drastically changing the order of the notes, Blue Sumlin's got one. Increase tempo, absolutely. Increase or decrease tempo is important. Now, what we can do as a close variation to present a challenge to ourselves is we can increase or decrease the tempo slightly. I'm talking like a couple of BPM. So this is a really interesting thing. If you find yourself practicing an exercise over and over and over again like this, and you get really good at it, and you find a tempo where it's just cooking, try dropping it by about 3 or 4 BPM and see what happens to your timing. It becomes exponentially harder, even though it's not just, you know, even though it's slower. It's very, very strange how this works, but let's play with that, right? So We're at 110 BPM right now. So if I play my exercise, and I change the tempo from 110 to, let's say, 107. Let's just drop that down a tiny bit. 107. I'm gonna play. Interesting. Something has happened. Now, you may not have even noticed the change in tempo because it's so subtle that you probably wouldn't even have heard it. But as a player, it feels different under my fingers. Now, that's because I've just slowed the tempo slightly from this little muscle memory speed that I'm just cooking at. So real quick, if I bumped it up to 113, let's try. Already, this is challenging because it's different. It's different. Now, that close variation has forced me to solve that motor problem. Now, I will say that this is not an exercise that I personally find terribly challenging because I've played this sort of exercise forever and a day. I've been playing guitar for a very long time, about 25 years, and I've played a lot of this exercise, believe you me, and a lot of close variations too. But let's take the exercise that I just made up, the exercise to challenge my little disparity between fingers 2 and 3, which is this guy. Let's try that with the tempo variation. And while we're doing this, I want some more suggestions about how we can vary this, because I want to know what you guys think. So drop us more comments, let us know other variations that you can think of, close variations. So here's 110, right? We'll change the tempo. Here's 110. So on and so forth. Let's try bumping that down to 106. Interesting. It becomes a little more challenging to stay relaxed. It's almost like I'm having to put brakes on. You heard me do that there. Talking is another issue, by the way. If you're trying to talk and play, some of the variation we can explore. Let's bump it up. Let's bump it up to a faster speed. Let's keep on going. So let's bump it up to, let's say, 116. Again, challenging. Now, what's interesting here is that it's not so much that it's harder, it's just that it's different, and it's different is what makes it harder. So what's interesting with this again is that we're not just like ramping the tempo for speed's sake, we're changing things to give us a problem to solve. Now, is there another way that we can change the apparent speed of what we're playing, the apparent speed, I will say, without necessarily changing the speed of the notes? Well, yes, there is. We can play it using a different subdivision. So let's say that we're happy at 110 BPM. Well, what about if we added 50% to the tempo and then we played this as triplets? So what I mean by that is if instead of playing at 110, we played it at 161. 161. Now, what this should give us is a much, much, much faster speed. And now we're going to play in triplets like this. Oh, let's do it again. Very challenging, because I have to think about it. But what I'm doing here is I'm using this principle of close variation to challenge my motor skills, so to speak. I'm applying this variation, which is forcing me to solve this mechanical or musical problem. Now, let's get away from speed for a moment. Are there other ways that we can vary this without necessarily using speed as our barometer? Well, what about if we change the position that we play something in? Because playing something here, and playing something here, and playing something here feels different. And that's why it's important not just to practice in the fifth position, for argument's sake, because the position of your fingers and the position of your hand relative to your guitar, especially if you play with quite an angled posture like I do, that is going to affect the way things feel as a player. So for example, let's say we try playing something down on position number one. So I'll take the same idea, 110 BPM, same deal. I'll play my little fingers two and three exercise. I might go. That's fine. Let's try playing it down here, position one. Ah, interesting. Let's try jumping up to fret number 12. Let's go. Again. And so on and so forth. So that feels different. That feels really, really different again. Now, let's go on. We've got some more great suggestions coming in. Also, by the way, when you're doing this stuff, if you're doing positional stuff for variation, I would probably encourage you not to do the one fret at a time creep, but just to make some bigger leaps so that you're kind of dealing with the idea of expanding and contracting the hand to solve the problem. Now, here's some more suggestions. I'm going to guess that is Matt. Ooh, let's read that. I've got my glasses on. I still can't read it. Matt. Ooh, that could be Matt Hisco. That could be Matt Fisco. Either way, great suggestion. Thanks for throwing it in there. That is, you use some string skipping. So, use string skipping is a really great way to deal with this stuff because it forces us to solve a mechanical issue. So what about if we use string skipping just to cross our different strings? So let's maybe try this. So let's try, again, I'm just gonna throw this out here. Let's try having. That works for me. Let's keep going. So, Felipe says, changing the note rhythm value, that's a very, very good shout. So maybe we'll try playing it as, instead of playing it as like 16th notes, let's try playing it as like a dotted pattern. Why not? That's going to be interesting. I realized I just did that against the drum beat in my head and you guys couldn't hear what's going on there. So let's try playing. How many times do I play? That's tough. And on we go. That's a very, very challenging variation. So really, really into that. Really, really into that. Blue Summerlin says, higher up the fretboard helps you play quickly. Well, it does to a point, but imagine you get up here. That's a difficult mechanical problem to solve because my thumb is all the way around here. So if I try playing my exercise here. That's tough. That's really challenging because I've got quite big hands and just getting into that space is a challenge. Even just kind of occupying this space where the horn of the guitar is a little bit challenging. So that's a variation, but let's stick with the string skipping idea. What about if we, instead of playing with string skipping, what about if we displaced certain notes by a string? So what about if instead of doing this, we took one of those little repetitions and moved it a string down. So instead of going like this, we go. That's tough. That's very, very difficult. Let's try throwing that into the mix. So here we go. Again, another problem I have to solve, but that's all good. We want to solve problems. So we try and pose ourselves issues so we can solve them. Let's try going. Very, very difficult. So what you can see here is that we can closely vary the exercises that we're playing to kind of present ourselves with new challenges. Now, this is, again, very, very important. I'm just going to reiterate this stuff. It's very, very important because the current literature on motor learning would suggest that close variation is the key to developing these motor pathways quickly and making them cemented in your brain to fingers kind of system. It is definitely the way to do things, I would suggest. So let's maybe take another kind of classic example. Let's take the classic Paul Gilbert exercise. I'm going to treat myself to just a little bit of gain for this, but I will turn the delay off because the delay may be a little bit annoying. Baptiste says, victory super kraken, always. Great amp, absolutely love it. Here's my super kraken. Here's a thought. Could sound be a way that we could vary our exercise? Well, yes, it could. Let me just throw this on real quick because I've got all that super magic gain. What about if I play my exercise now with a load of gain and now I have to keep it under control? So maybe I'll go. Ah, new challenge. Interesting. What about if I change the picking pattern? What about if instead of playing alternate picking, I try and do economy picking now? I go. Ah. And so on. Ah! Felipe, you hero, right? We have a great suggestion. I know we're going to go into a Paul Gilbert exercise. We'll get to that in a moment. Displacing accents. What a great way. What a great way to vary your practice. Because this is something people don't talk about so often. What about if we assign ourselves, again, I'm taking no credit for this. This is something my friend Nick Harrison showed me. What about if we take one finger and we accent every time we hit that finger? So what about if we accent every time we hit our third finger? That's going to be really difficult, but let's have a go. Let's find that out. So accenting every time I hit my third finger. Ooh, this could be fun. Let's go. My compressor. Oh, that's why. I've got my boost on. Let's try that again. That's tough. Let's maybe try changing it so I accent a different finger every time I hit a different string. So I'll do finger number one on the first string. I'll do finger two on the second string, finger three on the third string, finger four on the fourth string that I get to. That's going to be fun. So finger one first, finger one. That's very, very challenging. Very, very challenging. So changing which finger I'm accenting, man, that is thoroughly, thoroughly difficult. So yeah, anyway, great shout, accents. We could do accents in the bar as well. So we could do an accent in every third note, or we could do an accent on beat four or any of that kind of stuff. That is another way to create challenge in our playing. But let's go back to the Paul Gilbert lick and let's look for variations here. So this is the lick. Not the delay off very, very quickly. I'm gonna go to the close-up camera. The lick is this classic fella that you'll all have heard. We've played that a bunch of times. How can we vary this for our practice? You tell me, right? You guys tell me, how are we gonna vary that lick? So the lick is, starting with finger number one on the high E string. I'm playing it this way, by the way. There's a couple of ways we can play it. High E, fret number seven. Finger four, fret number 10 on the B string, or whatever string. Finger number two on fret number eight. Finger number one on fret number seven. We play, and then back up. How are we gonna vary that? You tell me. I'm gonna play this lick a couple more times, and then I want your suggestions for how we can vary it. See if we're thinking along the same lines here. Here we go. So let's play the lick a couple times. Now, as you can see, that is a lick I've played about 1,000 times. Probably more. Probably, I don't know how many... God almighty, I dread to think how many times I've played that line. But a few. But let's talk about variations. So variations we might try. Let's go back to the variations that you guys have suggested. So string skipping. Yeah, we can do some string skipping. That is a very fine way to change this lick up. So string skipping might look like this. We might play... more comments. Let's see what you guys have for me. Here we go. Marcin says, move some notes around. Absolutely. Well, let's move some notes. Let's maybe try moving the pinky finger. Let's move that out to fret number 12. This is going to cause an interesting stretch. That's difficult. Let's maybe move it to fret number 11. Let's move first fingers. Let's keep our first finger here. That's really tough. Let's do the first finger again. So first finger is going to stay on fret number 7 on the E string, but I'll put it onto fret number 5 on the B string. So I'll go. And now I'll play. Oh, that is difficult. Why have I given myself the challenge of doing that? Because I love you guys, that's why. Ah. That's better. What about if we try playing the high note with a different finger? What about if we try something like that? What about if we do it again, but this time we try accenting this note instead of this note? I've broken myself. That is very, very tough. Very, very tough. But this sort of thing is super beneficial for your practice because it gives you that key crucial variation that your work that you need to develop the pathways that you're trying to grow. So here we're trying to grow the pathway that is, you know, giving us this lick. That, you know, Muggins has played 100,000 times. But we're trying to develop not just that lick, but also the skills that surround that lick. Well, by varying our practice, that is 100% the way to do it. So let's recap, and then we're going to go to the Q&A because I want to know what you guys would like to talk about. I want to know what you want to talk about. I want to know what you're struggling with. I want to know what I can help you guys with. So to recap, principles. Number one, for technical practice, targeted exercises if you have a specific thing you're working on. Targeted exercises are the way to go. If you don't have a specific thing you're working on, big bang for the buck exercises are the way to go. So examples of those are exercises that we made up today. That's a good exercise for developing independence between fingers 2 and 3, but playing this 7th position of the melodic minor, so this is C melodic minor starting on B. Is a very good way to get a lot of finger independence exercise on the go with a comparatively little number of exercises. You can get a lot of work in there. So there's two principles. The third and most important principle is close variation. So find close variation, find ways to challenge yourself. There is one more that I want to throw your way. One more, which is how hard should your practice be? How challenging should it be? Well, there is a zone where the kind of magic happens. So if I take that Paul Gilbert exercise, let's say I play this exercise like this. If I'm trying to develop the skill of playing quickly, For someone like myself, who's done a lot of repetitions on this exercise, not super challenging. But I try and play it faster than I can. If I go crazy fast. Oh, man. It's just about there or thereabouts. Probably not the move either. There is a spot where you can control what you're playing, but you have to really think about it. You have to focus. And if you take your eye off the ball, it'll fall apart. You can't just zone out and just play it, which is kind of this challenge zone. Now, it can come in the form of tempo. So you can find a tempo where, you can play cleanly, pretty reliably, but you have to think about it. That's a good example of this. It can come with variation. You can find variations where you can play it pretty well, but you have to think about it. That is where the magic of the practice thing happens. So let's keep cracking. We're going to talk about some, or rather, we're going to take your questions. So if you've got questions, drop them in the comments. We will answer them in the Q&A. Before we do that, just want to take a moment to talk to you about GI Plus, which is, of course, our sponsor, because it's us. So we're sponsoring ourselves. If you want to support these streams, the best way you can do it is by, first of all, liking the video, subscribing to us on whatever platform you're watching this on, whether it's YouTube, Twitch, Facebook, whatever. A really good way to support the stream is by sharing it with your guitar-playing friends. But a really good way you can support us if you so desire is by checking out GI Plus. Links are in the description. It is the exclusive lesson platform from Guitar Interactive magazine. I'm going to throw a quick video on and show you what it's all about, and then we'll come back and we'll answer your questions. But first, this is GI Plus. My name's Nick Jennison, and it's a pleasure to introduce to you GI Plus, the brand new lesson platform brought to you by Guitar Interactive. We've assembled a team of the best players and educators in the world to bring you exclusive lessons covering everything from metal to blues to fusion and everything in between. Want to level up your shred chops? Check out How to Play Fast by Andy James. Or how about Sweet Picking with Rick Graham? Maybe country's more your bag. Well, how about a full-length exclusive country guitar course from Andy Wood? Interested in learning how to play over changes? Well, members get access to hours of exclusive lessons from fusion maestro Tom Quayle. Or maybe you want your playing to sound more soulful? Well, who better than Chris Buck to show you how it's done? Or perhaps you want to learn the secrets of the masters? Well, members get access to over 60 feature-length tech sessions where our tutors painstakingly decode the styles of players like David Gilmour, Eddie Van Halen, John Petrucci, Larry Carlton, Tosin Abasi, Paul Gilbert, and many more. You get all this along with exclusive live webinars, free backing tracks, competitions, and so much more. So what are you waiting for? Sign up for GI Plus today. Oh, there's a big GI over my face right there. Yeah, that's GI Plus, guys. If you want to support these streams, that is absolutely the best way to do so, is by checking out GI Plus. It is incredible value for money for what you're getting. I'm just going to throw that out there. I know I'm biased, but we're adding new lessons to it every single week. There's new stuff going up all the time. We just uploaded a new series from Tom Quayle. We have one from Sam Bell. I have a tech session. My Eddie Van Halen tech session's just gone up. I've done a Rory Gallagher one recently. That's going up very, very soon. We've got a new course from Sam, talking about metal rhythm guitar. It's all happening. It's on GI Plus. It's the place to be. So, your questions. Let's get stuck in. So, let's begin. Here's one I didn't get to last week. Blue Sumlin, what are your thoughts on coil split and push pull. Well, okay, I may need to get a different guitar for this, but we'll see. I absolutely love coil splits, just throwing it out there. I use them all of the time. But this particular guitar, is equipped with Fishman Fluences, as most of my gigging guitars are. So I like to keep some guitars around with regular wire-wound passive humbuckers, just because certain pedals get upset by active pickups like this. And sometimes in the studio, you kind of want that flavor, maybe, but 9 times out of 10, when I'm teaching, when I'm gigging, and a lot of times when I'm recording, I'll use my Fluences, and I have a variety of them. This is the Devin Townsend set, which is crazy versatile, right? So check this out. This is, I'm just gonna hide your comment, Blue Sumlin, but this is the Devin Townsend active sound, right? So this is like the EMG noise. I'm going to pull these two parts and listen to what happens. Let's throw a little bit of gain on there. Just a little bit. Loads of variation to be had. Now, I use push pulls all the time with my Fluence guitars because they have all these different voices that I can switch between. However, occasionally, what I'll reach for is a push pull on a passive equipped guitar, like my red guitar. So my red guitar, pardon me, which you guys will all have seen, has a pair of Bulldog humbuckers. They're a magical set of pickups. Just absolutely adore them. Made by Hayden Manette in, let me get this right, West Yorkshire. I want to say somewhere in Yorkshire. Yorkshire's a very big place though. So somewhere in there. Anyway, it's in Hayden's house. Sits and winds them himself. And the guy's a wizard. They're tremendous. But I know a few people who've had a similar set to mine. They don't sound like mine. I've had a similar set wound. They don't sound like mine. So we're not touching those pickups. Those pickups are sacred. But these pickups, absolutely killer. So anyway, back on the question. Big fan of push pulls. What I like to do for these as well, by the way, this is a little trick that I like to do, is when I'm playing, I like to set my amp up in such a way that the push pull just cleans things up just the right amount. So if I throw a backing track on, let's maybe try the ambient ballad, which is, yeah, this one right here. I'll throw this on real quick and I'll show you what I'm talking about. So let's go to the close up camera. Here's my little ambient ballad. Now, what I might do is I might set my amp up in such a way that it's like full on searing gain with push pulls engaged. And then if I pull the push pulls, this takes a little bit of that. Aggressiveness off. And then I push them in again. That's a little trick that I like to do when I'm soloing. So I'll use the push-pull as kind of like an expressive thing, something I'm a big fan of doing. So let's keep on going. Oh man, so many great questions have come in while I was waffling about push-pulls. So here's some more, right? Okay, more questions. You know what it is? I'll just answer this one as well, sorry. Blue Sumlin says Quad Cortex or Fractal FM9. I like the Quad Cortex. I like it a lot because A, I like the form factor. For my money, the amp captures are just outrageously good. Just phenomenal. Check this out, by the way. Here's a little comparison. So what I'm going to do, let me just turn this off. I've got a delay that I'm going to turn off here. bear with me. Bypass. I just have a quad cortex just here. What I'm going to do is I'm going to bypass the delay on my Super Kraken. I'm going to bypass the quad cortex. And I am going to A-B these guys for you right now. So this is the Super Kraken. Just keep your ears peeled. Because I have them both hooked up. So, Super Kraken. No delay on this. Let's mute that and let's bring the quad cortex up. Here's the quad cortex. Back to the Super Kraken. Now, this will sound different because I've got a different IR on them. So, they will sound somewhat different to each other, but man, you know, I'm a big fan of the quad cortex. I think it looks fabulous. Sounds fabulous. It does look fabulous too, though. So anyway, let's keep on looking. We've got some other great questions that I want to take a little bit of a peek at. So Marzine says, I find your playing refreshing and inspired. Can we expect to see something like a special episode of Play Like Nick Jennison? Would love to practice some of your habits. That is the kindest thing anybody said to me in a very long time, Marzine. That's really, really good of you. Thank you very much. I would love to do something like that. And I think maybe one day we will. But just you saying that has really brightened my day. Thank you very much. That's really nice of you. So let's keep going. Jason M says, when practice time is limited, do you think there's a hierarchy of techniques to focus on to give you the best bang for your buck? There absolutely is. Now, if practice time is limited, I would suggest the best use of your time is structured improvisation. And what I mean by this is structured improvisation is improvising with a goal in mind. So we may start with a needs analysis. So your needs analysis might be something like, I need to work on my alternate picking, let's say. I need to work on my alternate picking. Well, you may choose to improvise using strictly alternate picking. And rather than sitting and doing exercises, you may end up with an approach something like this. So I'm going to throw that track back on because I'm kind of feeling it. I'll treat myself to some delay because we like delay. Delay is good. And I may exercise with just alternate picking, but I'm going to improvise freely, and the goal is just to alternate pick everything. It's a little bit of economy picking, but you get the idea. So, the reason I think this beats, Jason, for your question, the reason I think this beats just doing exercises is you can do so much in 10 minutes with this, right? So you set yourself a boundary. You sit down with 10 minutes for 10 minutes with a track. First of all, you don't need to warm up because the warm up is baked in because you're just going to play at a pace or a difficulty level that is challenging but not impossible. So you're looking for stuff that you have to concentrate to play, but if you concentrate, you can play well. And we're just going to explore. You take your time and you explore whatever ideas come to mind. You can play any track that you feel like playing. You can play with any sound that you feel like using. But the reason this beats exercises is this also develops vocabulary. So you're developing musical vocabulary at the same time as developing your technical skills. So I think that is the best thing to do if time is somewhat limited. More questions. Let's keep on going. So we've got a little bit of time left. I'm going to address these real quick. Felipe says, how should we work on chords, arpeggios, triads? They are so close, using mainly 1, 3, and 5 intervals. Best way again to do this, we'll talk about this in a future stream, Felipe, because this is a Philippe. I have a fox called Felipe. Yeah, this is Philippe, or Felipe, whichever you pronounce it. I do apologize if I'm getting your name wrong. I'm getting everybody's name wrong. It's just a thing now, apparently. I'm going to talk about this in a future stream, so join us next week and we'll talk some more about that. Let's keep on rocking. So a couple more questions, very, very quickly. For descending legato pull-offs, both you and Rick Graham say don't put all fingers down. Yes, I do. Well done. Hey, well remembered. I say don't put all fingers down. Rick Graham says don't put all fingers down. And I must be right because Rick says so. And Rick is genius. So, yeah. How do we prepare? How do we do these pull-offs where you don't put every finger down at once? I.e. put the third finger down before pulling off to the pinky. Nor do you pull off and quickly hammer. Or do you pull off and quickly hammer on to the third finger? Okay, so I guess what you're saying here, I think I know the gist of what we're talking about. So I'm going to turn the delay off because it's quite annoying for this sort of thing. I think what we're talking about here is this idea of pulling off. Like this. Oop, how did I end up there? That sort of business. Now, what I'm talking about when I say don't put your fingers on at once is I'm not saying don't put a finger down that you're about to pull off to. What I'm saying is just don't have them all down. So if you're playing, let's take for example this A major scale shape right here. What I wouldn't have you do is start with all three fingers on and go like this. And then like this. So starting with all the fingers you're possibly going to need and then just pulling off through them one at a time, like dominoes falling down, I wouldn't encourage you to do that. What I get you to do instead is to have the finger that is responsible for the note you're sounding down, and then when you're ready to pull off, just quickly before you do that, or simultaneously, it doesn't really make a difference. It doesn't have to be absolutely simultaneous, as long as you're shooting for it being simultaneous. You're trying to make it simultaneous. That finger goes down just in time for the pull-off. So I'm not doing the hammer-on. I'm not doing the hammer-on and descent thing, although I have played around with that. It's quite good fun. That's without pull-offs. That's just hammering on. But yeah, what I'm doing here is instead is I'm trying to time the fretting finger going on with the pulling off finger happening. There we go. A light bulb moment. I've been putting all the fingers down beforehand. Yeah, it's a common mistake. The thing is, guitar players tell us to do this. And I think it comes from classical guitar, because classical guitar is a bit of a git to play. A bit of a... they're not the most friendly instruments to play, let me put it that way. You need quite a lot of strength in your hands to fret. So with classical guitar, it makes sense to keep as many fingers down as you can because you have to physically grip the string. But electric guitar is not like that. Electric guitar is friendly. It's easy to play. So what I'm trying to do anyway is I'm trying to time... I'll make this the last thought on this, by the way. I'm trying to time the idea of my finger going down simultaneously with the pulling off finger, which is not too different to the way that we play with picking, for example. So with picking, what we try and do is we try and time the arrival of the finger on the string with the pick on the string. So if I play, let's play on a string that's a little more clearly visible. Let's maybe try the... I've done this again. I have a black pick and you guys can't see the black pick against the black guitar. I do apologize. I'm going to buy some white picks so I can see what I'm doing here. But even still, what I'm going to try and do is we'll try and time the arrival of the finger with the pick stroke. We don't play and then put the finger on and then pick once it's on. Now, for some reason, this is obvious, but when it comes to pull-offs, which are basically just picking with the left hand, it's a little less obvious. And it takes a bit of practice if you're used to putting all the fingers down, but not as much practice as you think. So here's how I practice this, because it's a big, important question. The way I practice this is I would use my structured improvisation and I would set myself the rule of only having one finger on at a time. So that is my rule. I can only have one finger on. The floor is lava, that sort of thing. Maybe that's a UK thing, I don't know. So I'm back in E major. I would set myself the goal of one finger at a time, and I'm going to play using as much legato as I can. So I might try playing. You can see some instinct taking over there, where I'm reaching to mute notes with my first finger. That's just a habit that I have, but I'm not counting that because it's not actively fretting. And also, if I do make a mistake and I do end up with two fingers down at a time, I'm not beating myself up about it. I'm not going, you're a failure as a guitar player because that one time you had two fingers down. And I don't think if you just happen to do that in practice that, you know, 5 years from now, that will be the difference between you being a great legato player or not. I don't think that's quite how it works. But that's the idea. So Ruki has said on there, says, yesterday classical guitar for 2 years in college, they taught that. Well, it makes sense. For classical guitar, it absolutely makes sense. All bets are off for classical guitar. I know very little to nothing about the world of classical guitar, apart from what I've been told by friends who are practitioners. I am just not that guy. So there you go, guys. That has been a little bit of a peek at some practice techniques, or rather practice strategies that you can use in your own playing. Next week, we're continuing this stream, series of streams, but we're going to be looking at developing musical ideas. So we've talked about the idea of developing technical skill in this stream. Next time around, we're going to talk about developing musical ideas as an improviser, but also looking for things that you might compose with. Some suggestions, though, maybe a stream of the Q&As. I feel like we probably need to get another stream on just to deal with the Q&A, because I love the Q&A. It's my favorite bit. But I get so caught up in the lesson that I always end up overrunning. This is another really interesting one. So a strategy for building our sound. Now that is interesting. Starting from a clean sound and adding pedals and effects one by one. Okay, so strategy for building sound. I'm not going to answer this in full today. I will address this on a future stream. So please join us. I'll address this in a future stream. But I think the best way to start with building your sound is to have a very clear intention of what you want something to sound like. So start with the sound in mind and build from there. And what I'm going to say is anything that you add that doesn't add to your sound, get rid of it. So if you add a delay and you go, no, this delay does not add to the sound, then get rid of it, change it. Don't be afraid to be fairly minimalist about this stuff. I'm saying this, I have just the biggest, most preposterous rig that you've possibly ever seen. I could talk you through the signal chain, it's insane. Starts with the guitar, it goes into my wireless, which I'm not actually using as a wireless, I use it to gain stage and to take a DI. So it's like a DI box. It goes into my pedals on the floor, through my Boss ES8. I do like my ES8. So we've got a compressor in there that's not on at the moment. Bunch of fuzzes. I love fuzzes. This is my new favorite fuzz. JHS 3 series fuzz. Took that away from guitar shopping the other day. That goes into my amp. The amp has a Victory V4 preamp in its effects loop. We then go into a Wazer tube amp expander. The effects loop from there comes out into my Strymon stuff and into my noise gate and all that kind of good business. And then I come back into the tube amp expander with the left side, and then I run the right side out into a separate power amp and a two notes torpedo cab for stereo. And it's all so that I can do things like this, where I go. Because I do like me some stereo. Oh, and this noise as well. A bit of that. So there you go, guys. That's been a little bit of a look at some practice techniques. I'm going to leave you with some playing, as we always tend to do. My name is Nick Jennison. I will see you guys next week. Thanks once again. If you've enjoyed the stream, share it with your guitar playing friends, and remember to check out GI Plus, where you can find loads more lessons just like this. Here we go. Let's play the modern prog backing track. Why not? This is coming out soon. Here we go. My name's Nick Jennison, and it's a pleasure to introduce to you GI Plus, the brand new lesson platform brought to you by Guitar Interactive. We've assembled a team of the best players and educators in the world to bring you exclusive lessons covering everything from metal to blues to fusion and everything in between. Want to level up your shred chops? Check out How to Play Fast by Andy James. Or how about Sweet Picking with Rick Graham? Maybe country's more your bag. Well, how about a full-length exclusive country guitar course from Andy Wood? Interested in learning how to play over changes? Well, members get access to hours of exclusive lessons from fusion maestro Tom Quayle. Or maybe you want your playing to sound more soulful? Well, who better than Chris Buck to show you how it's done? Or perhaps you want to learn the secrets of the masters? Well, members get access to over 60 feature-length tech sessions where our tutors painstakingly decode the styles of players like David Gilmour, Eddie Van Halen, John Petrucci, Larry Carlton, Flash, Tosin Abasi, Paul Gilbert, and many more. You get all this along with exclusive live webinars, free backing tracks, competitions, and so much more. So what are you waiting for? Sign up for GI Plus today.